I'd like to talk a little bit about Aristotle. It's difficult to talk about Aristotle in just a few minutes because his thought is so vast. If you take a look at a collection of his writings, it's a substantial volume of material that's come down to us. And if you look at the table of contents in any edition of the works of Aristotle, you'll see that his interests were very broad. They were vast, actually. He was especially scientific mind for the ancient world. His teacher, Plato, as you may recall, we did a prior presentation on Plato. Aristotle's teacher, Plato, was much more interested in the interior reflection on the mind. He was intrigued by the fact that the world, Plato was, that the world of our senses focuses on, or the world that our senses access, is a world of changing material things that are always kind of coming and going. They're coming into existence and then they're passing out of existence. The flower out in the yard, or the grass, or the sunlight in the sky, it all kind of comes and goes. And so the world around us is filled with process, of movement, of becoming. And Plato was much more interested in turning his attention into the mind, where he discovered things through the power of deductive reasoning. He found things that seemed to transcend the changingness of the world around us. Like, for example, if the mind contemplates or thinks about mathematical truths, truths of logic, deductive conclusions that we can make about mathematical entities like geometrical shapes or numbers or whatever, those kinds of things have a kind of permanence and stability that the things of the sensory world don't seem to have. The flower outside will come to live and then it will die, but it doesn't seem to have anything enduring about it. Whereas 2 plus 2 equals 4 is something that I'm quite confident my great-great-great-grandchildren will still be studying and thinking about and assume as true. Not the particular flower that's outside. It will have long since passed away and wouldn't be around anymore. So the mind of Plato tended to gravitate toward those truths that have a stability and a permanence, and in his mind, an eternity about them, that they don't seem to be conditioned by time at all, that 2 plus 2 equals 4 is not something that's true because it's the year 2014 or whatever. It's true always. It doesn't seem to be the kind of truth that could be altered or could be changed. Whereas the world around us seems to be of a world of changing things. And why is it like it is? Why does the world behave the way that it does? Why do its does it seem to operate according to certain principles when we can imagine another set of principles that it could operate by? For example, I can imagine a universe in which the speed of light is different than it is in our universe, or gravity has a different kind of relationship or force exercised between two objects or whatever. I can imagine a universe in which those things are different, but I can't imagine a universe in which 2 plus 2 does not equal 4, or the interior angles of a triangle on a flat surface do not equal half the degrees of a circle. Those are things that deductively are certain. And that I can't imagine a world in which they don't hold true, but I can imagine a world in which the scientific principles that operate in this one are not true. So that led Plato to think that the things about which we can be most certain and sure are the things that the mind can reflect upon deductively within itself, whereas the things that we can't be sure of are the things about the material world, the sensory world. And so for that reason, Plato was not so interested in the sensory world. He was interested in the interior world. Aristotle, on the other hand, was very interested in the sensory world. He was very interested in science, and he wanted to develop a way, was very interested in developing a way to overcome the problem that Plato saw, that the world around us is changing so much, so we can't have certain knowledge about it. Aristotle wanted to say that we can find sure knowledge about the world around us. And how can we do that? Well, it's a very long story, and let me just suggest one or two things about the way that Aristotle would proceed in this respect. Aristotle thinks that even though the world around us is constantly changing, he thinks it changes because there is a principle of change in the world around us. And that principle of change he would call matter. Matter is that potential in the world around us to become, to be something different than what it is. The rain that falls from the sky has the potential of becoming, the matter of the water that falls from the sky can potentially transform into being grass or being something else. It can undergo what Aristotle would call a formal change or a substantial change. But there's something that has to be changing, though. And what's changing is the matter. So if you take a principle of change, which is matter, if you take that principle and you put it together with another principle, which he'll call form or substance. Form or substance is a principle of a particular kind of nature. Like, for instance, let's take the flower that I was mentioning earlier. The flower has a certain structure. It has an interior structure or set of principles that are forming the matter to be the way that they are. That's why the flower is a flower and not grass or not a tree or not a human being. It's because, for Aristotle, it has a different kind of organizing principle or structure. Now, that structure, that underlying blueprint or set of instructions in the thing, and none of those are terms that he would use, by the way. He uses terms like form and substance. That underlying informing principle, that underlying tendency of the matter to become the flower rather than the grass or the cow or the tree or the human, is what he would call form. So if you take form and you put it together with matter, you will get a changing thing that has a kind of structure stability about it, at least for a while. So while as long as that flower exists, it has an identifiable structure and a predictable tendency about it. If I know the nature of what a flower is, if I know what kind of thing that is, as long as the matter is able to sustain that form or that kind of substance, then I can predict what it will do, and I could have a science of it. And that's the point here about science for Aristotle, is that a science is about the forms of things, the interior structure of things, that does change because there's a principle of change there, but we can have scientific knowledge, we can have some certainty about things by studying their interior structure or their tendencies. Now, that's a very short look at that aspect of Aristotle's thought. Now, the way I want to approach Aristotle here for just a few minutes, since we're especially interested in his influence on Christian theology, is I'd like to look at him in relationship to some of the problems in his thought. And maybe by looking from a Christian perspective, maybe by looking at some of the problems in Aristotle's thought very briefly, we will be able to get into some of his thinking and the way that he proceeds in his philosophy. Again, there's far too much to say about Aristotle than what I can say in these few moments. But let me try to offer a little bit about Aristotle this way. If we fast forward in history from Aristotle to the time of St. Thomas Aquinas, so in the 13th century AD, if we go back to the 13th century, the thought of Aristotle had been rediscovered. The writings of Aristotle had been rediscovered. And with their rediscovery came some concern and some fear about what was found there in the writings of Aristotle. In particular, in the time of St. Thomas Aquinas, there were several areas of Aristotle's thought that were especially disturbing and unsettling. And those concerns about Aristotle tended to revolve around three questions or three issues. The first issue had to do with Aristotle's understanding of the world around us. Aristotle thinks that the world is constantly in motion and it is eternal. It never had a beginning. For Aristotle, the world is an endless process of becoming. That matter, that principle of potentiality or change, that principle of change has always existed, and that it has always been attracted to the perfection of God. Aristotle believes in God, and he believes in God because he thinks that the motion of the world requires the existence of God. The way that works is something like this. For Aristotle, anytime you have something that comes to be or changes, there must be something that is moving or causing that change. So take any particular change. Let's go back to the flower that I mentioned earlier. If I take the flower outside, it grows up, and now I see it in the yard. Now the question I might ask is, well, the flower wasn't there 3 days ago, and now it's there. How did that happen? And someone will say, oh, well, it happened because it rained outside, and there's lots of seeds outside that are blowing around. It's springtime, and they're popping up all over the place. There are flowers all over the neighborhood in the yards, wildflowers that are growing in people's yards. It's because there are seeds that have blown here from other flowers out there, and they're settling into the yard, and it rains, and the sunlight shines on it, the heat and the moisture in the soil, and that causes the flower to grow. We know that through observation, that things tend to happen under those types of causal relationships. So the seed added to the soil, added to the sunlight and the rain, all results in a motion. The motion is the growth of the flower. All of those things that I just mentioned are causes for Aristotle. They're reasons why the flower has grown. And so the flower will not grow. If I just take a seed and I put it in a vacuum somewhere, or I put it in a closet somewhere, it'll never grow. It has to be actualized. The possibility of the seed has to be actualized by some moving cause. But Aristotle thinks that you can't have an endless series of moving causes. Like, for example, if the seed grows into the flower because of the moisture and so on, the moisture that comes from the sky or the rain, it too must have a causal explanation. And the sunlight must have a causal explanation. In other words, those are things that happen, just like the seed growing is something that happens when it grows into a flower. So it is, all these other things have happened. They've grown, they've come to be. So Aristotle thinks that you've got a series of things that are happening in the world, but he thinks that you can't have an eternal or infinite series of things that are moving other things. You can't have that go on to infinity, because then you'd never have an ultimate explanation of why there's any movement. In other words, you've got an eternal process of motion or an infinite series of movers with nothing to ground it, nothing to support it, nothing to ultimately explain its motion. So imagine, for example, the tides of the ocean coming into the shore. The tides coming in, and they come in, and they come in, and someone says, well, what's the cause of that? And you say, well, that tide is coming in, or that wave is coming in because of that wave. And someone says, well, what about that wave? And you say, well, that wave, and another wave, and another wave, and another wave. And Aristotle thinks you can't go to infinity in waves that don't explain themselves being explained by yet another wave that doesn't explain itself. You've got to ultimately have something that is self-explained. And for that self-explained reality, Aristotle calls it God. And so, just like with the waves of the ocean, they're caused by something outside of the water, namely the moon, and the gravitational relationship of the earth and the moon and the waters of the ocean bring about the effect of the waves. And so the waves themselves don't ultimately account for their motion. The moon has to be brought into the explanation. So it is here with all the motions of reality. They're not explained by just their own selves, or just by an endless series of them. There's got to be something beyond them, and Aristotle calls that God. Let me stop here, and I'll continue this in a second presentation.